So what we're going to be covering today is threads and fasteners. What I want to do quickly, though, is go over the homework from a couple weeks ago. So what you should have in front of you, or most of you should have in front of you, if not, it's being handed out right now, is the auxiliary, or not auxiliary view, the section view. So some of you lost marks because of you put center lines in there. So what should happen, you should see that they're circled, but you should see your mark is being changed to reflect that the center mark should indeed be there. Okay, so if not, come and see me and we can look at that mark. So that's what we had to correct last week. So you can see the center lines are really faint in here, but you do indeed put center lines on section views. Okay, a common mistake that was made, or this question was actually done really well. If there's any mistakes made, it was usually in this area here or that area there, but for the most part, it was well done. Yeah, Joe.
Well, the bottom left is pretty ambiguous for what it could be.
Yeah. If you have another idea, come and see me. We can chat about what it could be. It was meant to be challenging in there. But yeah, so come and see me if you have another alternate way. Another easy marks, and a hint for the exam because we always put it on there. Simple marks. If you put these arrows here, you can't see the arrow over there. These arrows here, if you simply put the arrows on, you're going to get probably two or three marks, just simple marks. So make sure you always put the arrows on the section view. Okay, I mean, the arrows always point a view away from the section view. So the section view is here, so the arrows point away from it. Okay, that's the way that I remember it. Okay, this was done relatively well. Some of you lost marks. It looks like this part is circled. And you can actually see this one is incorrect as well. The reason this should be chamfered. So most of you have your that part circled, what you have is indeed incorrect. So is indeed correct. So I've got the marker to remark that. Again, if it's not reflected in your mark, come and see me at the break and we can make those changes. So that you should not have lost marks on that. That's incorrect. That should be chamfered. And the reason is because the answer key that we have is incorrect. Okay. Common mistakes that were made is with the CAD, we have a cut line that's here. That cut line is not shown through the cut material. So you should not have a line here, a line there, that represent those cut lines. Those lines aren't there when you're actually cutting through the material. Okay, and that's just the way that we do things. That's the syntax that we use to communicate.
So take that away.
What's that?
So take those away.
Those should be taken away, yeah. Yeah, does everybody understand that? That was a common mistake that was made. The other common mistake is keep the connection between the cut line and where the cut is, if you can. Okay, in this case you can. You can line them up so they're all lined up, so it's easy for you to understand. So you don't want to take this view and cut this, disjoint this view from this view and put it over here or change the configuration. Keep it so that it's all aligned, okay, if you can. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay, otherwise they're really well done. If you want to see what they look like in real life, I'll leave these up here as well. One thing before I forget, because I always forget, I noticed that everybody did a good job with it already here. When you do your project that we're going to start talking about this week, or any type of engineering week, you're going to be using B-size paper. The correct way to fold B-size paper, or the way that we want you to fold B-size paper, is just like the accordion. Okay, so basically what you do is you basically fold it over halfway like that, and then fold it halfway again like that. Okay, that's basically the way you guys have done it is correct. It's probably because it was done ready for you, but when you actually start doing your project, that's how we want it done as well. So what we're going to be covering today are threads and fasteners. This is probably, next to the auxiliary views, this is probably the most difficult topic in this course. It's not challenging because it's a difficult subject matter, it's just a lot of material that I throw at you at the same time. So just like the auxiliary views, which I think most of you understood by the end of it, I'm going to use the same tactic. So I'm going to give you a lot of information, so just try to keep your minds open, and then you're going to have some time to practice it and actually do some tours. The biggest problem, to be honest with you, that you're going to have with this is that I'm going to teach you how to engineer something, basically how to take a... Where'd my... There it is. How to take a top part and a bottom part and attach those two parts together with a screw or some type of bolt or some type of fastener. Okay, the problem is most of you probably haven't done this in real life. So I'm teaching you how to engineer something that you've actually not really done in real life, which makes it difficult. And I was in your boat when I was sitting in on the other side, when I was, I had never done anything type of machining or anything else like that, so it made it very difficult to understand. So the way I'm going to get around that is I'm going to try to give you a lot of information. I'm going to show you a video in a couple of minutes, and when you get into the lab, I'm going to, you're going to be going down to the shop, and they're going to be doing a presentation on how you actually make this part. So you're going to basically have the top part, and you're going to have the bottom part, and you're going to be joining those two parts with the fastener. They're going to show you how they actually make that. Okay, that will hopefully cement how the actual part is made and how put together, and that will allow you to basically engineer what you need to do for threads and fasteners. Okay, so chapter. Hopefully, most of you got my email about the textbook. Chapter 11 in the textbook is what we're going to be referencing quite a bit. We're also going to be using the annexes in the textbook. For this question on the exam, you're going to want to mark up your book, okay, or mark up your book by put little stickies or have readily available certain annexes, because we're going to be using those annexes quite a bit, and I'll identify them as we go along. Okay. The other thing that you're going to want to pay attention to is page 30 of your student handbook. You know, the handout that I gave you at the very beginning of class, the first day. You want to take a look at that, and once we get to that part, that's another reference that you're going to want to use as well. Okay. So without any further ado, this is what we're going to be the objectives of what we're going to be trying to cover today. So we're going to have different standards and types of threads, thread notation, and we're going to be looking briefly at drawn threads. Okay. Three applications of threads. Can you think of three applications? Why do engineers use threads? What are we using for? Charlie?
To secure things together.
Perfect. So we put things together. Why else?
You can take them out again if you want.
Yeah, we can take them out. Yeah, then that's one of the benefits, is you can screw things in and screw things out. It's not like nails where you're destroying the piece of equipment. Yeah, so that's still putting pieces together. Why else? It's still faster. Yeah, that's a good reason why we use screws. Why else? Perfect. Power transmission. This is a worm gear, so it allows us to transmit power. You turn one end, and it turns the worm gear, and it turns the other end. Okay, so that's a power transmission. That's another reason we use threads. Okay, one other reason, or one other major reason. There's probably more out there. I'm a cyclist. I love cycling. Gears, but what specifically? Does anybody cycle here? Yeah. What on the back, your derailleur, the derailleur, you have screws that do what? What do the screws at the back of the derailleur do?
They're feasible for making adjustments to them.
Perfect, exactly, and that's what the derailleur on the back, gearing, what you're doing is basically you have screws that basically change the position of your chain, which allows the chain to properly move when you shift gear. So it basically allows you to control the adjustments. Okay, so here we are. So whole parts together, adjust parts with reference to each other, like the bike example, and transmit power. What I'm going to get you to do right now is, in a couple seconds, we're going to be divided into groups again, and I'm going to get you to help me define some of these topics. So what you're seeing here, this is an external thread. So you've got a shaft, and an external thread is being put onto it. And we've got a bunch of different terms that define how the thread is made. And unfortunately, this is where I have to throw a lot of information at you, so I'm going to get you to present it. Okay, so if you want, you can use the board. Actually, I prefer a little sketch if you could. That makes it easier for them to go. This is what causes a lot of people confusion, is just all the different terminology that's associated with threads. And the reason you need this is for obvious reasons. If you have an external thread, so where's my... Who took my, Mao, do you still have my external thread? Okay, so if you have an external thread on your screw or your bolt or your some type of fastener, and you're trying to thread it into your internal threads, if they don't match, then you've got a problem. Okay, and this would be a major issue if you're dealing with, take for instance, World War II or World War I, where you've got the Allies on the North American side that are using a different one standard of threading, and you've got the British on the other side of the Augie using a different standard of threading. And now you've got parts, and you're trying to fix your parts, or you're trying to put parts together, and you've got different external internal threads, you've got major problems. So that's where a lot of these terminologies came up, and we'll talk about in a couple of minutes about some of the standardization that occurred. So it's vital that we get this right. Okay, first group, you guys are talking about pitch.
All right, pitch on the thread is it's the distance from one thread to another thread parallel to the axis. So the corresponding point, easiest point to use would be the very tip, but it works all the way at any point on the actual thread itself. U.S. standard for pitch definition is 1 over the TPI or threads per inch.
Okay, so you understand what James and Chris were talking about there. So in metric terms, it's the distance between crest and crest. It's this distance right here, and that's what we're going to be using. So it's represented in millimeters. So when I say pitch has a pitch of 5 or pitch of 4 or whatever the case is, that's the distance from crest to crest. It's how many millimeters is between crest to crest. In the ANSI or the U.S. standard, what they do is that they look at take an inch, and they count how many crests that there are within that inch. Okay, and they're obviously and that's the way they do it. Okay, just same thing, but just different represented differently. Okay, everybody good with the pitch? Pitch is a crucial part of the screws and fasteners. So make sure you fully understand that.
So the crest is the top surface here where two threads meet. And there's the center line there. You see? It's just the top part where two threads meet.
So root is basically the opposite of crest. It's just the part down here, this flat part, instead of on top here.
Major diameter is just like the widest part of the screw thread. So just go here, from crest to crest.
Yeah. So it's here's your crest.
Yes.
Or so here's your crest up here. Here's another crest here. It's the distance between the two crests. Okay. So it's the largest part of the screw. Okay. Whereas who's doing minor diameter? the gentleman at the back.
So minor diameter is basically the opposite of major diameter. It's just from the root to the root. It's the smallest part of the screw, and it's just the distance from root to root.
Okay, so if for whatever reason you got into specialty of designing your own screws, and or you made your own specialty screw, then you would be dealing with minor diameters. Most of the times we do not touch minor diameters. It's important to understand it, but we don't usually define screws based upon their minor diameter. We do define screws based upon their major diameter, which is from crest to crest, and also the pitch, which is the distance from crest to crest.
So depth of the thread is the distance between the crest and the root measured normal to the axis.
Perfect. And again, if you're dealing with the theory of screws, if you get into specialty, that's when you would be dealing with that. But as long as you understand major diameter and pitch, that's what's really important.
A chamfer is a beveled or sloping edge, and it's dimensioned in accordance with its angle from the offset. So this one would be 45 degrees, and it exists on threads and screws to make it just easier to insert.
Yeah. Cool. Does everybody understand that? So if you didn't have that chamfer on there, and I'm trying to insert this external thread into this internal thread, if I haven't got that chamfer, I'm going to be immediately stuck. Whereas if I have that little bit of chamfer, it gives me a little bit of leeway that I can kind of wiggle it in there and then start turning. So that's most screws or bolts or fasteners will have that chamfer at the very end. Okay. Yeah.
Curiosity, wouldn't a bolt usually have a flat end with a bit of chamfer, whereas a screw will have right up to a pointed end, so it's easier putting wood.
Right. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I'm interchanging. Yeah. You're right. The bolt, but a screw. Yeah, would definitely have the pointed end. So it depends what you're inserting it into, like wood or anything else like that. But yeah, it depends on the type of screw. But yeah. Cool. Everybody good? Okay. Angle of thread. I think that's the last one.
The angle of the thread is basically the angle between the two slopes here, like that.
Okay, so again, a huge amount of work has been done in the past with the angle of the thread, the minor diameter, the root, and all these other terms. And it is important. And if you get into mech eng, you will look into it. But for this course, you have to understand that this is what a thread is made up of. But really, the most important things that you need to know is the major diameter. What's again the major diameter?
Widest part of the.
Perfect. So you can go to. So you can use David's definition, which is from crest to crest. Or you can use the biggest part of the screw, or the thickest part of the screw or the bolt. Okay, that's the major diameter. And the pitch, what's the pitch again? That's the next important one. Yeah, Paul?
The distance, I guess I'd say, it's almost, think of it like a wavelength. It's like one wavelength of the screw.
Yeah, exactly. So it's the distance from crest to crest. Or when you're dealing with metric, and that's how we're going to be dealing it. But if you're dealing with the U.S. standard or ANSI standard, it's going to be over 1 inch. How many crests do you have? Okay, so that's simply what screw theory is all about, or screw theory or fastener theory. Okay, so we already talked about major diameter. We already talked about pitch. What we're briefly going to touch on are these three components that define threads. Okay, so the first one, the thread form, you can see there's a bunch of them up here. The way it's basically the shape of the thread. Let's see, the ones that we're gonna be using, we use metric and what's it unified. Where's the unified? So metric and unified are the ones that we use. This is the ANSI, the American standard. This is the metric or the CSA standard, and there you can see they're very similar, but they are different. Okay.
Yeah. Or is that a
yep, they're squared.
And
can you look at, let's look, but just for fun, let's look at some other ones here. Where would you see a knuckle type form?
Light bolts,
perfect, yeah. So anything that's basically really simple to the thread. What about a buttress?
I don't know, it's that one way. Like a crank. Okay, you crank it, and it locks every time you turn it.
So what are you transmitting?
Well,
What are you transmitting when you're doing it?
It's a gear, like force, but it only goes in like one direction.
Yeah. Perfect. It's a type of gearing. It's used to transmit power. For anyone that goes into naval engineering, you'll see a lot of those on ship. Yeah?
Same on drywall studs, too.
On drywall studs, yeah. Oh, the screws, yeah. Hmm. It's dealing with force. Anytime you're dealing with force, which makes sense if you're trying to keep it up there, you're going to use drywall studs probably to prevent, because it's got a force coming down, holding up. I'm guessing that's what it's used for. Cool. Anyway, so those are the basic thread forms that you can you'll come into contact with. So the other thing we're going to be looking at is thread series. We have our metric again, our ANSI, those are the types of thread forms. And within metric and ANSI, you can see that they're subdivided. Most of the time, you're going to be dealing with coarse, and in some instances, we're going to be dealing with fine. Fine basically just refers to the pitch. You're going to have a very, very fine pitch, more basically smaller distance between the crests. Okay? And that's basically used. It's used a lot in like aircraft or anything that where you don't want the screw to rattle out. It's you're going to use that fine, or anything that's very very meticulous. Okay, the third component is thread grade. Basically, it's the strength of the material. The screw. It's basically how much stress or strain the screw can handle. We basically, generally what you'll find with bolts or is they'll have a number, and that number will be on the head. And it'll be one is the weakest and two is the strongest. If you get into mech eng, again, we'll spend a lot of time dealing with those type of thread grades and strength materials of the bolts. Okay. The final one is the class of fit or tolerance. So what this basically is indicating is class of fitter tolerance. What was I talking about here to do? So in this case, here's the ISO standard or the metric standard. This is telling me, and we'll talk about it in a second, we have an M metric, M for metric, 16, which is the major diameter. That's the pitch. So it has a major diameter of 16 millimeters. It has a pitch of 2 millimeters, which is the distance between the two crests. This is referring to, I always get it mixed up, this is the planned clearance. Okay, because the individual here wants a certain type of clearance between two parts that are put together. So there might be a planned clearance between the bolt and the top part, that because we have a clearance hole. This, the 6, is referred to as the tolerance. So this is planned. This is what we want the differentiation to be. This is actually what's acceptable. So remember when we talked about dimensions, we had the plus or minus. This is basically the plus or minus. And these numbers mean something. Earlier in the course, we used to go into detail about this. I'm going to just gloss over it, because if you go mech eng, you'll spend a lot of time dealing with tolerance in the machine course. But just understand that basically nuts and bolts have tolerances. They can be plus or minus certain distances. So if you're dealing with aircraft, you're going to have a fine tolerance. If you're dealing with just basically drywall screws, then you're going to have a less of a tolerance, or you're going to have you're more inclined to have errors in the distances. Okay, make sense? Okay. So now we talked about the major diameter, we talked about the pitch, and then with that we talked about the thread form, the thread series, the thread grade, and the class fit or tolerance. There's also, those are basic screws, and most of those are what are called right-handed screws or bolts. We also have some unusual type of threads, left-handed threads. Can you think of an example of a left-handed thread?
Gas valves.
Where? Sorry?
Gas valves.
Gas valves, are they?
Propane tanks.
Oh, okay, yes, yeah. So, and why do you think they're that way?
You can't take the hair to make a bomb out.
Yeah. It's basically, yeah, it's for safety reasons. Another thinking for left-hand screws or bolts?
For wires, if you want to put tension between two wires attached, it's like a bolt on either end.
Okay.
Put in and crank it one way and they both crank together.
To get together? Okay, cool.
Any machines that use a lot of like rotational things, you put the other one so it doesn't
loosen. Yeah. So what would be a good, I used the example earlier with the bike. Bike pedals. If you ever try to take your bike pedals off, one side it's a right-hand screw, and one hand is a left-hand screw. And it depends on which way, because when you're biking, you obviously don't want your pedal to come off when you're biking. Not a good thing to happen. So basically, what right-hand means is when you righty-tighty, lefty-loosey. So when you go clockwise, the screw tightens. A left hand is the opposite. A left hand, if you turned it left-hand way, the screw would tighten. Does that make sense? So right hand, it's going to tighten for a right hand screw, and left hand, it's going to tighten for a left hand screw. Ready to go with that? Cool. Multiple starts. What are those, and why do you think we use them? Any ideas, David?
You have multiple positions that you can actually start screwing in versus just having one set.
Perfect. So my water bottle doesn't do it. Does anybody have a water bottle here? So it might be.
Like if you wanted to line up something, you could have two
stoves. Yeah, it's usually on not good water bottles, but like the cheap plastic ones. They'll have a cap, and for this cap, it's a single start. So I have to position the. So you can see here, I've got to turn it, and it only will catch. It will start threading in one position. With a multiple start, there'll be like two or three four gaps that allow you to start different places. Okay, so and that's what a multiple start. So you find them a lot on consumer containers that you want to open or close.
Sooner as well.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, I think we're almost done. Okay, thread notes. The big thing here is just like with everything with dimensions, we don't expect the person to be taking a ruler and actually measuring the dimensions. Well, the same with the threads. We show threads are symbolically represented, and then we actually use numbers to represent what we want. So the diameter, the major diameter, the pitch, the type of screw, we use that information. Okay, but so we symbolically represent the threads, and then we use leader lines and writing to identify the actual specific information that we want. Okay, so this is where I need you to keep your minds open. Okay. So the whole point of what we're really covering here is you have this part here, and we want to attach it to this part here. So one of the benefits of using a screw or a bolt, as we talked about earlier, is you can take that screw or bolt off. And so you can put it in, you can attach it, and then when it's come time to do some maintenance, you can unscrew it, and you can take the parts apart. Okay, so that's the benefit of it. So what's and this is where, for those of you that have no background in machining, that it's going to be a little more challenging. So here's our bolt or our fastener or screw, whatever you want to call it. This is our top part. Here we have external threads that are on our screw. Talk to me about what's going on in here. Are there any external threads on this top part?
They're internal.
No, there's none.
Oh, the first part you mean? Yeah.
Right, so this is what's called a clearance hole. So there's external threads on the bolt or the nut. This is all smooth, and it's what's called a clearance hole. So the major diameter of this, the hole here, is going to be bigger than the major diameter of this the screw. And that's to allow that to, we want no interaction. Okay, you can see how there's no interaction there. We don't want any interaction. That's not the same for the bottom part. The bottom part has threads. Okay, so the bottom part, we're gonna take the threaded portion, pass it through the top part, but then once we get into the bottom part, that's when we're gonna have to start screwing. So there's internal threads in the bottom part. Okay. Now you're gonna hear this word here, tap. Tap is basically a fancy word of saying threading. So when you see if you want to tap something, that's basically it's called threading. It's what for whatever reason that's what they use. So if you want to tap something in the machine world, that's called you're threading something. Okay. So let's go through this here. So here we've got a block. So it's this block part. So we've shown the threads here, the external or the internal threads here, and we've just used the symbology. We'll briefly talk about the symbology. But the main information specifying what type of thread is indicated up here. Okay, so we're looking at this part right here. Okay, so again, what do I have in here? Internal threads, external threads, or is this smooth?
Internal
threads. Okay, so there's internal threads in here which are going to mate with the external threads of the bolt or the fastener, whatever the case it is. Okay, so we point to it. We use a leader line. We've got it's symbolically represented with these dashed lines, and we put the tap drill diameter. What the heck is that? What's a tap drill diameter, David?
It's like the diameter of the part that makes the thread on the inside. Is it not?
Not yet. You're thinking of the tap. That's down here.
Oh.
Anybody? How? And this is where, unless you've done it, you're not going to understand it. This is so. In order to make these threads, the first thing that the operator is going to do, you're going to see this this afternoon, is they.
Is it the diameter of the hole that you make first?
Perfect. Okay. So what they're going to do is the technician is going to take this part. He's going to take a drill, and he's going to drill the hole first. And the drill is going to be smaller than the minor diameter of the bolt or the fastener. Okay.
But depending on your material, you don't always need to pre-drill your hole when you're self-tapping a screw.
You can do it.
You can just use a self-tapping screw and
it'll go through. Okay, sounds good. So yes, sometimes you don't need it, but for the cases we're going to be working with, which is metal and brass and stuff like that, you're going to need it. Okay. So so the first thing you're going to do is you're going to drill the hole first. The hole is always going to be smaller than the minor diameter of your fastener. Okay, and then what you're going to do, telling the technician is going to go into his tool crib and he needs to select the type of tool bit or the drill bit that's going to make that hole first. Then he needs to know how deep it's going to go. Okay, so instead of that X there, you'll sometimes see that symbol. Okay, so that he's going to first drill his hole. After he's drilled his hole, then he's going to take out what's called a tap. And you'll see that this afternoon when you go down into the shop. And the tap is basically just, it creates the threads in the hole. So he's got a smooth hole, which was done by this step right here. Then he's going to use a tap in order to create the threads in that smooth hole, the internal threads. Okay, and the way that he's going to do that, and this is all this information here. So the major diameter and the pitch, that's going to specify the type of tap that he's going to be using. And then the thread depth, that's going to tell him how deep he's going to want to put the threads in. Okay, everybody get that so far?
Is there a way to start the threads later on in the hole, or do you have to have a wider diameter first before, like say in that hole there, you don't want the threads to start right at the top.
Right here?
Yeah, you want to start down lower. So would you have a larger drill bit to go down first a little bit and then tap it? Or?
Ask the technicians. Yeah,
you
Yeah, most of the time the threads start right at the very beginning. Yeah. The threads don't go to the very bottom, but we'll talk about that in a second. Okay, everybody good with that so far? So that's specifying the threads, the internal threads here. Okay. So for the drill size, the tap drill diameter, this is where I need you to go to page 830 in your textbook. This is a page that you need to mark off, and I guarantee you, you use it for the homework, you use it for your project, you use it for the exam. So you need to flag that page. 830. So if you go to 830, what you'll see down one column is the nominal size of the threads. And again, the M stands for the metric. The next number, say the top one is 1.6, that's the major diameter. And the next value is the pitch. Okay, so all you basically do, you go down this text, you come along to the line that you need, so the major diameter and the pitch that you're dealing with, and then you figure out what your tap drill that you need. Okay, that's how you get this value right here. Okay. And you see here's a cross section of what you're seeing here. So what the first operation that the technician did is they drilled the first hole to this depth. Then what they did is they came along and they threaded, and that's represented by these dashed lines, to a certain depth. Okay, so you see that there's two depths here. There's the first depth, which is the smooth drill, and the second depth, which is the threaded portion. Why the difference? Joe?
Because when you're tapping it, what basically happens, you have basically a really strong screw that you're screwing in, and it will compact the size. And at the beginning to start it, it's chamfered up, so you can't thread it all the way down. Plus, you don't always need all the threads.
Threads, yeah. And the other reason, there's other reasons, but basically, you, as you're threading, it's not a perfect process. You need to completely turn the tap to create the threads. So the threads at the very bottom here are not going to be perfect threads. So if you try to screw your bolt or your fastener into imperfect threads, you could seize your nut or bolt. So that's generally why your thread depth, drill depth, why you go 2 to 3 pitches more than our screw. So if our screw or fastener stops here, you always want to make sure that you have 2 to 3 pitches extra of good threads, okay? And that's basically what we're saying. Where's my drill depth? Here's the drill depth. That's the tap depth, the thread depth. So you always want 2 to 3 pitches more than your screw length. I'm missing the screw length there, okay? And then the reason why is because you want to make sure you have good threads. And the same thing, you have also another 2 to 3 inches or 2 to 3 pitches where the threads end off. For the same reason, or for the reason that Joe was saying, physically you need a place to put the tap, but also you want to, when you're tapping, you're also going to be having little shavings and stuff like that. You don't want those shavings getting involved with threads of your bolt or your fastener. Okay, Again, this is something, just try to keep an open mind, and once we do the example, it'll make more sense. Everybody good so far? Okay, and again. So we talked about this part already. So here we have internal threads that are our external threads of our fastener are made into. Next, we're going to talk about this part here. So this part here, we said, is smooth, and there's a clearance hole here so that the major diameter of our thread does not interfere with that clearance hole. We don't want any interaction. So we already talked about this, but this is important. This is one of the things that you just need to experience with. But if you don't understand this part, it gets very difficult. So we have a clearance hole that's here, and this is the part. If holes are larger than 10 millimeters, we want to add approximately 1 millimeter. If holes are less than 10 millimeters, we add about 0.5 millimeters. And again, this is all approximate. So there are, and I'm going to really quickly, what we used to have you do is actually have to draw the representations of the threads, the external and the internal threads. We've moved away from that because now we're going to get the CAD to do the work for you, which will save you guys a lot of time. But what's basically shown here is we have an external threads and we have internal threads. They're represented in different ways. If you want the more details on that, just go to chapter 11. It will go through the different types. Okay, and the standard that we use in Canada is called the CSA standard. So here we have a block. If you're looking end on to the block, so like this, that's how you represent the threads. And this is how you'd show a section view, just with a simple line. So there are the threads. And here is the view that's not sectioned.
Well, that middle one there for the standards, are those dashed lines supposed to be full circle, or is it actually just
a... This one? That's supposed to be a partial circle. It's like a C. Okay, and that's what it looks like. The same thing, the threaded portion. So you can see here, this is the threaded portion that's been tapped. This is the drill hole that's smooth, and that's the end of the drill bit. Okay, and that's front or the top view, and that's the bottom view. Okay, and that's what it looks like with the cut section. And we used to spend way too much time on trying to get you guys to do this. And now I just need you to understand what you're seeing there. So again, this is our threaded portion. That's the non-threaded portion, and that's the bit at the end. And again, with the screws as well, we get you to try to draw the screws, and that used to be a pain in the butt. Though you do need to know when you do the problems. Where is it? If you go to page 836 to 837, that's another page you need to mark off on your books that you're going to need. The reason you need that is when you do your calculations, you need to know, for example, you need to know the thickness of the head or the diameter of the thread. And why would you need to know that? Well, you need to know that because of when you're specifying your counterbore. You also need to know your depth of your head, because that's going to specify how much it's going to sink into the part. Okay, so that is we used to have you draw these, but now I just need you to, if you go to 836, 837, that will give you all the information you need to do the calculations. Okay, and that's what it looks like together. So that's we have a bolt. That's our plate or our top part, and that's our base. And the bolt is holding the two parts together. Here we have a clearance hole. So you can see that there should be, you'd expect a gap here. You don't show the gap in the real drawings. And again, that's just standardization. That's the way it's just showing. So we have the bolt. The bolt is here. We have the internal threads or the external threads of the bolt. We have the chamfer at the end of the bolt. There's a clearance hole here. So there's no internal threads here or here. There's external threads on the thread or on the notch of the bolt or the fastener there. Here, now we're into the base. So this part here, into the base, we have the meshing of the internal and external threads. So for this period, only here. And then the bolt or the fastener ends here. And then we only have internal threads. And then we have the original drill hole that's smooth. Okay, so that's what you're seeing right there. Okay, as long as you understand that, basically, that's all that I want you to get from that. There will be, basically, one of the big reasons you are going to deal with threads and fasteners no matter what you're doing in your career, guaranteed. For short-term reason, though, is that there will be there'll be one question on the final exam that's on specifically on threads and fasteners. Okay, so the homework that we're going to be doing is basically geared towards preparing you for that question. So for the sketch part, I'm going to let you guys do this on your own, but the A9 bolt ID, this needs to be completed. So basically all you're going to be doing here is you've got A, B, C, D, E, pointing to different screws, and what you need to do is simply identify the screw. So you basically put the description of it. Prefix is obviously going to be M because it's metric, the diameter, the pitch, and the length. And if you go into your textbook, pages 836 to 838, that's going to give you all the information that you need. So it's basically getting familiar with the different types of screws that are out there. Okay, so I'm going to let you guys do that on your own, but that's due. The next part is due is this question here. It's three pages. It's called 8-9 part 01 base, 8-9 A9 part 2 cap, and A9 assembly with fasteners. And basically what it is this. So you have your base here and your cap here, and you're putting screws in the cap so that you can keep those parts together. And that's all. We're adding notation to all these three drawings so that you can create this assembly. Okay, and that's what we're going to be doing in class with me, is I'm going to be going through step by step how to do those calculations. Okay, so that's also due. And that's all that's due for sketching. Next part is A9 practice basic mates, A9 practice 2 cylindrical mates, A9 practice 3 mating strategy. Those are just for your practice, and obviously, and that's the last CAD practices that you guys are going to be getting. Okay. Then what you're going to be doing is A9 CAD assembly drawing, and there's three pages associated with that, and that's basically one of the homework CAD parts that you're going to be doing. So you're basically going to be putting that piece together. Okay. So that's a fun little exercise. Okay, and then the final part is the project. So the project information is here, and it's basically, we let you basically do your own thing. So what you're gonna basically do is creating a whole package, an engineering drawing package that will allow somebody to make this trolley system here, okay? So there's the trolley system. You're going to be creating the drawing package in order to do that, which is it's kind of cool. So it's basically use all the information that we've covered in the whole course. So basically what you do is we have this week, we have next week, and the following week, which is basically it's basically all your time to work on it. Next week I'll give a small lecture on working drawings, assembly drawings, but it's very very short. But most of the time is yours to use as you see fit. So for this week, I would aim at getting through all the CAD and also starting to work on drawing these parts in CAD. Okay, I'd get a start on that, and I'd make sure you get the sketch part of the threads done, but you should be able to get that done because you'll be doing that with me in class.